I wanted to say that remind everybody that next Sunday, end of May, is Pentecost Sunday. So as we often do when we gather together, I encourage us, as many as can remember, to wear red. And another announcement, I hope you've seen that Logos bookstore is open, and I went there and tried to shop them out this week, but I wanted to remind you that this book, Spiritual Disciplines Handbook, is now in there, and wonderful resources. Today's scripture text is Jesus' prayer in John 17, and this has some wonderful things about prayer in it, even an appendix, Postures for Prayer, talking about the different postures biblically, culturally. So I encourage any of you that don't have this yet, pick it up.
Very good. And Carl and Becky are even coming to us live from Logos.
Yeah. The
stock room at Logos Bookstore. Okay. Then today we have a very special prelude, and I hand it over to Lila Kuraya.
Good morning, everyone. Hope you're all well. Hi. Thanks to David, I can now not only be heard, but I can be seen. This morning, I'd like to share a song that actually my beloved Mark had encouraged me to learn and sing over 30 years ago. And I know I sang it probably for a worship service, like maybe about 35 years ago. I chose this song as we have all been spending a lot of time at home, in our homes, because of COVID-19 and the stay-at-home orders. Because Jesus loves us so much, our lives and our homes are filled with so much love. It is this love of Christ that grounds us and steadies us and fills our hearts and homes with love. As I sang this song, I thought of many, my personal family, and many of you, my church family. So I share with you this morning this song called Love Will Be Our Home, thanking God for His amazing love in all of our homes.
If home is really where the heart is, then home must be a place we all can share. For even with our differences, our hearts are still the same. And where love is, we come together there. There, love will be our home. Wherever there are children singing, where a tender heart is beating, we can live together there. Love will be our home. With love, our hearts can together in one place. Wherever there is laughter ringing, someone smiling, someone dreaming, we can live together there. Love will be our home. Where there are words of kindness spoken, where a vow is never broken, we can live together there. Love will be our home. Dreaming, we can live together there. Love will be our home. Wherever there are children singing, where a tender heart is beating, we can live together there. Love will be our home.
Thanks, Lila. That was great. Gloria.
Wow. Love will be our home. That means God is our home. So let me call you to worship with these words. Praise God, who brings life out of death and hope out of despair. Praise God, who has raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Praise God, who gathers up the fragments left by human destruction and creates new possibilities. Christ has risen. Christ has risen indeed. Let us pray. God of new possibilities, we're reminded as we look into your word this morning that you have a vision for our world that far exceeds our present reality. You are our home. May we never forget that. May we be surrounded by it wherever we are, whatever we do. You call us out of cynicism, out of fear, out of apathy, wanting us to keep our eyes on you, our home. We're grateful for the things you bring into our lives that give us courage and determination to work for better relationships, for justice, for peace. Help us to find the language and the courage to share with each other our faith stories and to be open and honest and humble as we interact with each other, be it over technology or in person. Knowing that Jesus has prayed for us, may we deepen our identity as your children and be strengthened to carry on the mission, your mission, each day that we live. We remember especially this weekend with Thanksgiving, the service of so many throughout the years in defending our freedom. Help us not to take our freedom for granted. Thank you for the promise that if the Son makes us free, we are free indeed, no matter what our circumstances. We pray for our world and for those nations where violence and tyranny causes so much suffering. May your Spirit be working there to bring healing and peace. We pray for those who do not have enough food or water or a job to support themselves. Use your church to alleviate the suffering. We pray for those who are ill, be it with COVID-19 or some other illness that threatens our lives. We pray that you will be with them, that your Spirit will comfort them and bring healing and hope. We think of our preschool this morning as they have begun preparations to open again in the near future. We ask that you give wisdom to the teachers and administration as they work to make it safe and a wonderful learning opportunity for our keiki. We also pray that you would give our church wisdom as we consider what we need to do in order to be able to open and meet in person again. God, we feel so helpless at times. Help us to remember that you are in ultimate control of everything. We ask that you be our light. Remind us that you are our home. In Jesus' name, we pray, and we pray together the prayer Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thanks, Gloria.
You're welcome. I'm wondering if there are any children here today, this service, or will it be the later service most often? Have we seen any children sign on? Okay, I'll turn it over.
Keith, it's time for the scripture.
Okay, good morning. Today's scripture comes from John chapter 17, verses 1 through 11. First one. After Jesus said this, he looked toward heaven and prayed, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might have eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, the Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I've had with you before the world began." And Jesus prays for his disciples, saying, "I have revealed to you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you, and you gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine, and the glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one.
Thanks, Keith. As Gloria mentioned at the beginning of the service, when she was speaking about that book on spiritual disciplines, this text is the beginning of what is often called Jesus's high priestly prayer. It comes at the end of what we think of as the Last Supper, just before Jesus leaves the room with his disciples and goes out and is arrested. And in the first few verses of this prayer, one of the main themes is glory. Jesus says his hour has finally come, the hour of his being glorified. But what kind of glory is this? How would you define glory? If someone asked you, what is glory? I found that it's one of the harder kinds of words to define. But in the Old Testament, here's a kind of a technical Old Testament definition of glory. Glory is God's majesty made visible in acts of power. God's majesty made visible in acts of power. It could be something natural like a thunderstorm. But more often, it's something God does, like in the Exodus miracles, parting the sea, sending the manna and quail. And in the New Testament, John, more than any other gospel, presents Jesus as the embodiment of God's glory. We beheld his glory from John chapter 1, from the very beginning. We beheld his glory, the glory of the one and only. And Jesus performs acts of power, certainly, turning water to wine, feeding 5,000, healing, raising Lazarus from the dead. But John's gospel does something that the other gospels don't do quite so boldly. In John, glory is also revealed in the death of Jesus. When Jesus' hour comes, when he is going to be glorified, it's time for his arrest and crucifixion. So there's a different kind of glory going on here. Certainly the resurrection is also part of the glory of Jesus' hour, but the Gospel of John makes it clear that Jesus' glorifying involves his suffering and death. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains only a single grain, Jesus says in chapter 12. But if it dies, it yields a rich harvest. And a few verses later in chapter 12, Jesus says, "What shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? But it is for this very reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." So it's here in John 12 that we get John's version of Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane. So where the world sees the cross as a sign of death, defeat, humiliation, and powerlessness, John wants us to see that exactly in this dark and dismal sign, we can find God's victory over death, God's victory over Satan, reconciliation with God, and the power of our salvation, a very different kind of glory. The majesty of God revealed in an act of power, but paradoxical power, the power of sacrificial love. And in the second part of our reading, Jesus prays for his disciples, and by extension, for us, for all who follow Jesus. And I like what one scholar said about this, that Jesus did not leave behind a system, a book, or a program. He left behind a community of which we are now a part, a community marked by the glory of the cross. If you've ever wished or wondered what it would be like to go back to the New Testament church I think our pandemic experience may be giving us a taste of what life in the early church was like. We haven't been able to gather like we used to. We're facing a lot of uncertainty and stress, and we don't have the power to fix this. And psychologists tell us that this adds to our stress because we've gotten used to being at least being able to do something to make things better most of the time. But while the church doesn't have the power to make a pandemic go away or to prevent an economic downturn, we're given a different kind of power, the power of the cross of Christ that has for two millennia empowered the church to experience hard times and to shine the light of Christ where we can in the darkness. Because that's where the Gospel of John says the light shines, in the darkness. A darkness where we can see a different kind of glory. What we can see in this different glory is love, or another word often used here is compassion, which means to suffer with, to feel what another feels, to share in that suffering. And this is what Christians do, with and for one another, with and for the world. Henry Nouwen, the beloved author and teacher, was one who knew this well. He wrote a book called Compassion, and he said, consolation is not the avoidance of pain, but paradoxically, the deepening of a pain to a level where it can be shared. Consolation is not the avoidance of pain, but paradoxically, the deepening of a pain to a level where it can be shared. This is what God did in Christ. Shared in our humanity, suffered with us to the death. The cross does not give us the power to fix every broken thing or lift every terrible burden, but it does point us toward sharing in suffering, sharing in bearing a burden. And when we do, we find consolation, because where two or three are gathered, we also find him, the one who suffers with us. This is a stressful time for everyone, from our youngest children who suddenly couldn't go to school, to our elderly who are at the greatest risk in this pandemic. And I wanted to offer encouragement this morning from this passage where Jesus prays for his disciples and us, and thank God for the word and for the example of the early church. And then the mail came into the church this week, and with it a bunch of envelopes with the response forms that we sent out, inviting folks to send in prayer concerns and praises. And I found myself being encouraged by what you sent in. And I won't mention any names, but I want to share three responses that came in this week, because I think all of these, as well as many other forms that we received, all demonstrate the consolation we can find in our own church community. The first note is from a woman who said she thanks the Lord for healing me of about a month or more of extreme anxiety during this time of uncertainty. She had many uncomfortable symptoms and resulting in extreme insomnia. And she said, with the help of many prayers and some medication, she's doing much better. She says that the Lord is restoring both my mind and body day by day. I'm able to eat and sleep now. And I think a lot of us can identify with insomnia or trouble sleeping. Another member sent in this prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, please use your divine power to abate this COVID-19 devastation to our planet, our nation, our state of Hawaii, our communities, and our families. Please give guidance to our officials to do what is right for your people. In Jesus' precious name, amen. And another woman sent in this prayer. Thank you, God, for giving all of us some free moments to reflect on anything possible. We are now forced to sit still and hopefully listen to you. After 30 years of work, bringing up the kids and nonstop errands, coming to a screeching halt is a blessing many of us have not had in a lifetime. Thank you, Lord, for all we have. Amen. I hope we can share more of these notes and prayers and thoughts in the weeks to come. They certainly have a kind of a power to console as we share something of what we are going through. Things are in motion here at the church. As Gloria mentioned, the preschool is gearing up. And in fact, they plan at this point to open their doors on June 3rd. And they are going to do it following to the letter the guidance on safety and distancing and keeping things clean. And so that means they're going to be limited to 10 students per classroom, with two teachers in each classroom. And as a result, we are converting the Kingdom Kids room in the CE building to another preschool classroom. And when we're back with services here, and Kingdom Kids is back in up and running, Kingdom Kids is going to be held upstairs likely in the corner room next to the Sunday school office. So there's a lot of things going on here on campus, and it's a moving target that we're working with. And because of the mayor's proclamation last Thursday, which I think many of us were kind of surprised at it, but the churches on Oahu are now permitted to gather physically. And we checked into this, apparently not with a 10-person limit. As long as social distancing is maintained, from what we understand, we can fit as many people in our sanctuary as we can with 6-foot spacing. And I checked, I kind of eyeballed this, and we can get more than 50 people in the sanctuary here with 6-foot spaces, every other pew, only 2 or 3 people to a pew. But our question is when you will be ready, when you will feel that it is safe and wise to return to on-site services. And so we are preparing to send out a survey, both electronically and by the Postal Service, to find out from all of you how you're feeling about this prospect of returning to the church. Because that's going to be very helpful for us planning when things do start up again. And the survey is going to go out to English-speaking and Japanese-speaking people. And from that, we will take our next steps. We will not rush into this. We know that there are especially for our elderly members, we don't expect you to return as soon as it is possible to do so. And we want you to feel, whenever you do choose to return, that it is a safe thing for you to do. And we also know that because of the way that this virus is most easily spread, when you get a group of people together in one building, in one room, and you sing, we will not be singing congregationally for a while. And so that'll affect how the services run, how long they go, and how they feel. And I know I'm going to miss that very much, as I have been already. But this is, we know that singing, like churches do traditionally, is a high-risk kind of activity for this virus. But we're going to send the survey out as soon as possible. I believe we can do it this week sometime. It'll take a while for the mail-in surveys to get back, and then we will plan for our next steps. Perhaps we may open up a service here before the end of June. I don't know if that will happen, but I'm pretty confident that unless something changes externally, we we will be able to do so some Sunday in July. And I hope you will all participate in the survey. Let me close with a prayer. Gracious God, we lift up all these concerns and plans and unknowns, and we lift up our preschool as it is gearing up to open its doors once again. Thank you for the staff who have been coming in to plan meticulously, especially for Sandy, our preschool director. Keep her healthy, keep her at peace, and together with the preschool staff, make them a team who are able to bring about the opening of our preschool in a safe and excellent way. Thank you, O God, for your word and for the cross of your Son, in which we also share in your love, the assurance of your love, and the experience of your consolation as we share in your life together. We lift up our hearts to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, Gloria, communion.
Communion. If a few of you need time to get your bread and the fruit of the vine together, please do that now. All right. It was a time of uncertainty, as Wayne said, for the disciples, that last meal they had at Jesus, where he prayed for them. And he was reminding them, abide in me, which for us is remember me, that you are not alone. I am with you always. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. You who come to me won't hunger. You who believe in me will never be thirsty. We join the company of all those who are hungry and thirsty for spiritual food as we come to the table in remembrance of Jesus this morning. And Jesus will be our host wherever we are as we come. We recognize that we're sinners. We can't save ourselves. It's Jesus himself who has given his life for us, who will meet us wherever we are as the word of God is spoken and as we eat and drink together. It's the Holy Spirit of God who will keep tending that seed of faith that has been planted in our lives. For these amazing gifts, let us give thanks. Holy God, we thank you for your constant love that is home. We thank you for the gifts of your creation, for this beautiful place that we call home. We thank you for the people of faith that have tended those seeds planted in our lives. Thank you for those you use to call us to faith. We especially thank you for Jesus, you sent from your own being as our Savior and as our Lord. We thank you for Christ's birth, Christ's life, Christ's death, Christ's resurrection, and that he will come again. Thank you for gifting us, reminding us that we're not alone. You've given us your Holy Spirit, who will keep building us as your church until Jesus comes on that last day. We ask that as we share together, you'll bless the bread and the fruit of the vine that we take with the outpouring of your Spirit, so that through that meal we can be effective servants of yours, that we can be salt and light and yeast for the growth of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Here again, the words of Jesus in that last meal he shared with his disciples before his death. On the night of desertion and betrayal, Jesus took bread, gave God thanks, and broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And yes, it is a bagel. In the same manner, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." By eating this bread and drinking this cup, we proclaim Christ's death, we celebrate his resurrection, and we look forward to his coming again. These are the gifts of God for we, the people of God, wherever we are gathered. Let us partake now together. The body of Jesus broken for you. Strength for the journey. The blood of Jesus shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Let us pray. Thank you, O God, that you want us to never forget, and that you've given us ways of remembering that you're always with us, surrounding us with your love. May we go forward from here, serving you wherever, whenever, however we can, through the power of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's declare together what we believe. Christ has died.
Christ has risen.
Christ is coming again. Hallelujah.
And receive the blessing. Wherever you are, wherever you go, know that Jesus prays for you and keeps you in his grace. May the love and joy and peace of the Spirit be with you throughout this coming week. Amen.